He's a smash with the young adult crowd and huge with the YouTube crowd. Of course, I'm talking about Brook critic Steve Donaghy. No, I'm talking about John Green. But I kind of have them both on today's episode of Book of the Day. Welcome back to Book of the Day. So glad you could join us for another week of frivolity and books together again at last. And I am joined by Steve Donaghy, the critic who reads everything because somebody has to, and you're it. How'd you get tagged for this job?
Hello, everybody. I think I got tagged for the job because I don't sleep. Oh. Might have something to do with it.
We'll have to talk about that sometime. I have a CPAP with your name on it, sir. So we'll figure something out. We're talking John Green today, and as a devotee of your channel, you've had a lot of words about John Green in the past.
I have.
How you feeling about his essays here today, Steve?
You may be thinking. For the readers who don't dote on my channel, you may be thinking, what could you possibly object to with John Green? He sold a squintillion skid load of books to the very demographic that is least likely to read them. He's made readers out of thousands and thousands of people. But my beef with him comes from the fact that I read those books. And
he's affable, Steve. He's so affable.
Yes, he's very affable. Yes, indeed. But the illustration that I always use, when you say, well, we can't hold his books against him because they turn on so many young people to reading, the illustration that I want to use is, well, if handing out syringes of crack cocaine to students all over the country proved to be an excellent way of getting them over their fear of needles, you would still criticize that. you wouldn't say, well, we can't really. I mean, sure, they're as high as kites, but they're not afraid of needles anymore.
By any means necessary.
You would think that the caustic opinions that I have about John Green would be ameliorated by the fact that we're talking today about a collection of nonfiction. Mm-hmm. Something of what I feel about that collection, you could probably determine by the fact that I doubled over almost horizontally when you called them essays. I had a hard time even getting the word out.
You have a hard time getting out the word Anthropocene.
We are talking about the Anthropocene Review. Most of these things are transcripts from his podcast by the same name, because we know that as readers, we are in fact living in the end times. Where a book that you open is a transcript of podcasts.
By the way, at the end of next year, the Book of the Day podcast will be transcribed and available at your corner drugstore.
He adds in this book half a dozen pieces. I don't want to call them essays. A half a dozen riffs, a half a dozen pieces, a half a dozen, hey, did you notice? That weren't ever podcasted, as far as anybody knows. I don't know how anybody gets through even one episode of this podcast. I listened to three and felt like I was having my eyes drilled out of my head.
And I leafed through this thing and I felt a sort of a young Andy Rooney thing going on here, kind of. Is that kind of what's going on?
It doesn't bring out the Andy Rooney in you. Nothing will. Not that any of our viewers under a certain age know who Andy Rooney is. But he was a comic at the end of the old TV show 60 Minutes that used to just carp about everything. John Green's fiction will certainly bring that out in anyone who is going into it without already loving it. If you go into it already loving it, the vast amount of his audience went into every one of his books already loving it. Mm-hmm. They are all members of Nerdfighteria. They are all, you know, don't forget to be awesome. They are all part of the internet group, the YouTube community that he and his brother formed and maintain, mm-hmm. that has its own vocabulary, its own zoology, its own astrology of symbols and images. These people are as diehard fans get. And they gave John Green an experience the like of which you can hardly think of for something that will be harmful to a writer. They gave him the experience of walking into a 60,000 seat auditorium and having it all stand on their feet and uproar and cheer and scream because they've seen him.
Yeah.
Before he's even said a word, just because they've seen him. You go to your publisher with that, with a video of that conference, and they're going to say, we'll publish whatever book you write. Go home and write us something and we'll publish it. That's what we want. We don't care about you. We want that. But you won't hear that. Instead, you'll hear exactly what anybody, we're all human. In that meeting, we would hear, we want you. When the publisher is really saying, we want that. And they got it.
Yeah.
Book after book after book. Oh my God, the books are so epically, seismically, tectonically horrible. They're so horrible.
So a little treacly. The few I've read get a little treacly.
Slap in the face, void of substance, just completely void of substance, where a half page exchange of dialogue can go, okay, 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 okay. And that makes its way onto a t-shirt for a Nerdfighteria convention.
There is so much subtext though in that. I mean, I feel, it gives me all the feels, Steve. I got the vibes.
The Anthropocene Reviewed is not fiction. It's not his next epic novel. I once said that this guy is just trying as hard as possible to troll the critics by writing crap like this. And then his own brother proved me wrong by writing even worse books. He wasn't. Someone in the family tried even harder. But this is not fiction. These pieces in here, these chapterlets, are not fiction. But they also aren't about the Anthropocene. We should probably explain to our listeners.
Absolutely.
Anthropocene is a casual term used for the current era in human life, much yes. like Triassic or Jurassic. Referring by, you know, Anthropocene refers to the fact that every aspect of the world today is governed by humans or dramatically influenced by them. You now, the upper Midwest is currently battening down the hatches for a massive winter storm over which the upper Midwest has no control whatsoever. So it's easy to look at that term, Anthropocene, and think that's wrong. But just 10 years ago, a probe at the very bottom of the deepest part of the Marianas Trench found plastic. And microplastic fibers have been found in virtually every living organism that's ever been examined for them.
Certainly, yeah.
Including organisms that have never been found before. They're still eating and breathing this stuff, and it's also in your babies. It's in human babies. They're born with it. So I think Anthropocene as a term is accurate. True, winter storms and hurricanes make us feel like we're the playthings of the earth, but those winter storms and those hurricanes will both be drastically different when there are no more any frozen ice caps on this planet, which is Indeed. Going to happen in the next decade. Right, if you don't right. think that's going to affect everything, and that's humans. Humans did that. That's not a natural thing. That's not the Melanchthon cycle at all. That's humans doing that.
Our snow removal tools have gotten really good, Steve.
Your coping tools are going to have to get better and better. But you might think, okay, well, you're talking about a big, multifaceted, serious subject. So you must like the Anthropocene Reviewed. No, no, I don't. And the reason why I don't is not because when John Green talks about that subject, he's not interesting. He is. When he talks about that subject, he's interesting. The reason why the book fails is because, as I was trying to sort of illustrate, the entirety of his writing muscles, all of the yardsticks, all of the gauges, all of his internal mechanisms for how to determine whether or not what he's doing is working, mm-hmm. were entirely shaped by worshipful 13-year-old girls.
Yeah.
And as a result, this book reads exactly like that. Yeah. It's called The Anthropocene Review, but 30% of it is about the Anthropocene. The rest is about, hey, did you notice this thing? Or I noticed this thing and here's what I want to, oh, wait, what about this? Oh, wow. Well, I didn't see that coming. Every sentence, every paragraph larded with Zoomer approximations of kid speak from 10 years ago. All of it is, I always tend to say the books of John and Hank Green will work better than plutonium in dating. In carbon dating for future generations. They can dig up bones in the dirt, or they can watch, you know, whatever the public streaming service will be in 2122.
Yes,
they could watch that and maybe ask Steve Bannon. I'm sure that his podcast will still be running. He's been federally indicted. He has been given a prison sentence. He still does a podcast. So I don't imagine anything's going to
change. Is that what this show is missing, Steve? One of us needs to be indicted.
It's only a matter of time. It's only even if just for quality measures, it's only.
We're putting out a call out there, just so you know.
No, but these pieces zing and pop all over the place.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but the thing is, the irony is that no longer appeals to the majority of the people who made John Green write that way. It now appears to their daughters.
Right. It's been around for a while.
Well, but if the mothers can age out of, well, yeah, that was really zany, but I kind of want you to sit down and talk about this. You are, after all, talking about the end of the frickin' world. Maybe you could sit down and concentrate. If the mothers grew out of that, then why hasn't Green grown out of that? Why is he still writing like this is my ultimate question for this horrific episode.
I would argue to gall you.
The legion of Nerd Criteria burning us in effigy. That is my ultimate question. Why is he still writing like this?
Mm-hmm.
It's the question that I've been asking for 50 years about Stephen King. Why has this guy not learned a single thing about his craft? Why? Why has he not learned a single thing or changed at all?
Well, there's something about commerce.
Oh, right.
Steve, I mean, I don't want... Okay.
So it's not an entirely rhetorical question. There is actually...
Right. Far be it for me to remind you what country we live in, but you know.
All right. Okay.
It's my job. Right.
There is an actual answer to my question. It still bothers me.
Clearly. I knew when I selected, Steve was kind enough to allow me to select some of the books today because these are actually plucked right from our nonfiction shelf this week.
What fun. We're talking
intentionally
about walk in and see.
They're just waiting for you. And I knew when I snapped my little picture of John Green's book that this would be a colorful episode, and you didn't disappoint. So I'm very glad.
The subject has been the subject of many good books.
Yeah.
But pulling your zany, hey, did you know, wild YouTube graphics routine about the death
of times
life on Earth.
Yeah.
And you might say the only defense to that is that not much of the book is about that subject, but that just underscores the fact that this guy does not exercise any control over his own craft.
Yeah. It's working for somebody. It's working for somebody.
Yes. Oh, lots. Is it popular at the library?
It's weird. That one is waiting to get some toehold, I think. I bought a couple copies thinking that it would because of who he is. His novels do well. Yeah. No, that's very cyclical. You'll see a lull and then another little spike. And I feel it's the same thing, like an older brother saying, oh, you got to read, Me and Earl and the Dying, whatever, Paper Town, whatever it is that he's famous for. And so it's cyclical. I mean, you just see a little spike, a little hiccup. Hank never. Hank Green's book just disappeared.
So someday we will do an episode about Hank Green.
Oh, I hope so.
The reason why the Anthropocene Review bounces all over the place and talks about his morning coffee or his view out his window or what he thinks about his kids is easy to diagnose, which is that this is not the Anthropocene that he's talking about. It's the Greenocene. That's all. Change that title and the book makes perfect sense.
There we go. So it's a bit of navel gazing and a lot of navel gazing, perhaps. And
color spread in the middle of the book of his navel. I think. Maybe you cut it out of your Wisconsin edition.
We're not allowed. No censorship here at the Cedarbrook Public Library, unfortunately. So here we are.
Oh, I'm just trying to get an irate patron to come in and say, I was told there'd be navels. You have to explain, ma'am, we really can't tell what that critic is going to say. We really don't know.
Just in the Boston edition, not in the Cedarburg edition. All right, folks. Hey, it's John Green and it's his essay-ish thing, whatever it is. And let us know what you think of this thing in the comments below, or you can come in and throw it at my head. You can't really do it for Steve, but that's we'll see how that goes. Hopefully it doesn't elicit any violence. Steve, we're back tomorrow with more selections. Internal. This is a special week. These are internal selections of the Cedarbrook Public Library. here on having well,
if you ever wanted the experience of having a cranky old Boston book critic walk side by side with you through the library saying that stinks, that stinks, well, that stinks too, let me tell you why. Well, we're here to serve.
This is your week. All right, everybody. March up to Christmas. How perfect. All right, everybody. Have a wonderful day, and we will be back tomorrow. And something a little cheerful. I don't know. All right, take care. Bye, y'all.